Hello, I'm Clive Davis, and I've spent my life in the wonderful world of music and all that it entails, which is far more than people know about or hear about. Contracts, sheet music, literally hundreds of items that I might not have been able to do if I were going blind or if I was totally blind. RP International has led the way to find a cure for blindness. And as Helen and RP patients say, put the music back in my eyes. I want to see again. And she and our other hosts throughout the years are doing just that. And they're doing it at this special time of the year. So let me introduce some of the wonderful supporters of this broadcast. It's wonderful to see how this Eyes of Christmas idea has grown. It's really a terrific idea, describing Christmas for the blind. And it's people like them who help in the fight to cure blindness. Please join me in this fight by calling 1-800-FIGHT-RP and make your donation to help end the scourge of darkness. My friends, I believe in this cause, and I really hope you do too. Please give now, 1-800-FIGHT-RP, or go to rpinternational.org. My thanks to you, and remember, keep the music going in your own life, no matter what. And call 1-800-FIGHT-RP or go to rpinternational.org.
Welcome to the Eyes of Christmas. I'm Vin Scully, and this year we present the Eyes of Christmas live. And are you in for a treat? And as we watch and listen together, please pick up the phone. Call in a donation to fight blindness now. Call 1-800-FIGHT-RP. Please, that's 1-800-FIGHT-RP for a holiday pledge to fight blindness.
This is Bob Costas. The Eyes of Christmas brings light and hope and laughter to the eyes of blind children, adults, and seniors all across the world. I'm proud and happy to be part of this Stop Blindness campaign and hope you do your part to light up darkened lives. Call 1-800-FIGHT-RP and light up the holiday season for someone who could see through your eyes. That's 1-800-FIGHT-RP. You can write to the Eyes of Christmas at P.O. Box 900, Woodland Hills, California, 91365. Thanks.
Here's the holiday release of 20th Century Fox.
On December 25th, the kids are home, but they're not alone.
Our grandparents are totally clueless.
This Christmas.
Do you know what time it is?
Hey! Get your taser ready.
The kids are in charge.
Yeah! We gotta get to school.
$20. Thank you.
And the holidays.
What's wrong with your face?
Parker!
will never be the same.
Did you get my e-bike?
Yep.
What's up, home slice?
We are so past here.
I thought I was doing okay.
Not today, sir.
Parental guidance. Rated PG. Christmas Day.
Whether he is saving Private Ryan or going back to Forrest Gump, always worth listening to and sharing his memories of Christmas, the remarkable American actor Tom Hanks.
My Christmas memories were really about, I always took the bus to my mom's house. So when I was growing up, Christmas and the Greyhound Bus Company was a synonymous kind of thing. You know, you get into this packed bus and everybody's got Christmas packages and you're sitting in the back and you got about a 5.5 hour drive up to my mom's house. The individual presents I got, you know, I'm an American, so you kind of like chew them up. You know, you get it's not like that, oh, I just want this one thing for Christmas. I always wanted at least one thing for Christmas. I can't remember what they were now. But Johnny 7 OMA, never got it. Never got the Johnny 7 OMA for Christmas. Didn't get it. I remember my brother got slot cars once, you know, and that was like off the scale. It was like, this is like getting a Mercedes-Benz for your 16th birthday. You got a slot car set. You got a slot car set. I don't remember what I got that year.
Now here's a lady who's stunning, smart, and talented. Grab your child close and enjoy this performance together, bringing out that youthful spirit that exists in all of us. Here's Miss Vanessa Williams with her version of What Child Is This?
Memory from the Christmas past of Beyoncé Knowles.
Hi, this is Beyoncé, and my most memorable Christmas was Christmas of 97, where we woke up and I spent the morning with my family, and the second half of the day we performed. And it was really memorable to me because it was the first time that I performed on Christmas, and I realized that people wanted to spend their Christmas watching us perform, and it really felt good.
Please look at the screen now, and for the first time, perhaps you will learn more about the simple test that can alert you to the symptoms of macular degeneration. It's called the Amsler grid. This simple grid can help detect some of the earliest forms of eye problems. First, hold the grid at your comfortable reading distance. Wear your usual reading glasses if you have any. Second, check one eye at a time by covering either the right or the left. Third, with the uncovered eye, focus on the grid without removing your gaze from the dot. Can you see all four corners of the grid without removing your gaze from the dot? Do all the lines appear straight and continuous? You may see dots appearing intermittently at the intersections. This is a normal optical illusion. Repeat with the other eye. If the answers are all yes, you've passed. If the lines appear wavy or distorted, you should make an emergency appointment with an eye doctor. Any formal eye exam should be done by an ophthalmologist or an optometrist. For additional advice or to learn more about the 10 symptoms most commonly associated with vision impairment, please call 1-800-FIGHT-RP or visit us online at www.visionawards.com. Once more, 1-800-FIGHT-RP. Thanks.
It would not be Christmas without Charles Dickens, of course, and his wonderful classic story of Scrooge. So in a moment, we want you to enjoy a part of this classic. But before we do, a small explanation. First of all, for those of you blessed with sight, you will see the movie. But you will also understand and get the reason behind why we actually make films for the blind. So sit back, watch, and listen, and maybe learn as well. And remember to send a donation to Post Office Box 900, Woodland Hills, California, 91365. Or call 1-800-FIGHT-RP now.
This film is in black and white. The title of the film appears in white letters against a scroll. It reads Scrooge, based on a Christmas carol by Charles Dickens. Directed by Henry Edwards, a Julius Hagen Tokenhelm production. Scenario, H. Fowler Meir, production supervisor Hans Brahm, photography Sidney Blythe, William Luff, original score and musical direction W.L. Tritel. The players, Sir Seymour Hicks, Donald Calthrop, Philip Frost, Robert Cochran, Mary Glynn, Oscar Ashe, Athene Sailor, Barbara Everest. Another sign, also in calligraphy, white lettering on gray, is Preface. I've endeavored in this ghostly little book to raise the ghost of an idea which shall not put my readers out of humor with themselves, with each other, with the season, or with me. May it haunt their houses pleasantly and no wish to lay it. Their faithful friend and servant, Charles Dickens, December 1843. We see the village's skyline of pointed rooftops with square chimneys. It's a foggy night. A man wearing a hat and scarf walks bow-legged and slowly. He carries a tray strapped around his shoulders. He walks by some street musicians playing the flute, clarinet, and horns. A black-top street lamp is lit. Snow lines the windowsills, and snow is on the ground. Another man in a black coat and taller hat pulls a cart. Black iron gates surround a brick building leading to a wooden sign outside Scrooge's office. Scrooge is a white-haired man hunched over his desk. Only his back is shown. He works by candlelight and writes with a quill pen. Books cover the corner of his desk. Another rectangular-shaped desk has a single book, some paper, and a briefcase laying on it. Long drapes hang from the window. Another man, Bob Cratchit, works at a desk in the back. He also works by candlelight. A white candle burns brightly in a slender candle holder. Bob is about 40. His eyes are close to the page. He has straight brown hair, a small chin, and a wide forehead. His shadow is cast behind him on the wall. Bringing his hand to his face, he blows on them, then warms his cold fingers by the flame of the candle. Bob brings his hands back to his face, blowing on them, then clutches his body, holding himself tightly. Bob's reflection is seen in the mirror as he passes by Scrooge's desk. Scrooge lifts his head to watch Bob in the mirror as Bob bends down to pick up coals from a bin and places them in a shovel.
May I inquire, Mr. Cratchit, what you're doing with that shovel full of coal?
Why, I beg your pardon, sir, but the outer office is intensely cold, and my fire...
Your fire?
I should have said your fire, sir.
Yes, sir.
It shows symptoms of going out, and I thought I might venture to replenish it with a small quantity of coal. Yes.
Well, of course, you know, it's very evident to me, you know, Mr. Cratchit, that you and I left apart. Oh, I see no help for it, sir. You don't pay for the coal, so you can afford to be reckless. Therefore, very evident to me, sir, you know, that my interest is not your interest, nor my welfare your welfare. Get on with your work, sir. That'll keep you warm enough. I'm not cold. Why should you be? When I'm your senior, by a great many years, I fancy.
All about a small shovel full of coal.
And none of your mumbling, you know, none of your mumbling.
Scrooge curls his finger, motioning to Bob Cratchit to approach him.
You have a wife and family to support, I understand.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. How many children have you got?
Around half dozen, sir. Three boys and three girls.
Tut, tut, tut. Can I afford a wife?
Yes, sir.
Eh?
I mean no, sir.
Have I any children?
I don't know, sir.
Eh?
No. No, sir.
How much am I constrained to pay you a week for your services?
15 shillings, sir.
Be to your interest, sir, to see that you're worth it.
Scrooge is about 60 years old. His hair is straggly, his bushy eyebrows and a rounded nose. Cratchit goes to his scarf and winds it about his neck and returns to his cold office. Freddy, a very tall man in a high hat and black cape, carries packages through the streets. He passes by a number of men chatting and strolling, as well as a young brunette woman standing alone. Freddy makes a purchase from a street vendor, then enters Scrooge's office, setting his packages on Scrooge's desk.
You can't mean that, I'm sure.
I do mean it, sir. What right have you to be merry? What reason have you to be merry?
You're poor enough.
Come then. What right have you to be dismal? What reason have you to be morose?
You're rich enough.
Bah! Humbug.
Oh, don't be cross, Uncle.
How can I help being cross, sir, when I live in such a world of fools as it is? A merry Christmas. What's Christmas time to you, sir? It's a time for paying bills without money. Time for finding yourself a year older? Not a penny in it, sir. If I had my way, sir, every fool who goes about saying Merry Christmas should be boiled with his own pudding and buried with a stake of olive to his heart. He should.
Uncle!
Nephew, you keep Christmas your way. Let me keep it in mind.
Keep it? But you don't keep
it. Well, let me leave it alone then. Much good has it done you. Much good will it ever do you.
It's the only time I know of in the long calendar of the year when men and women seem by one consent to open their shut hearts freely. And therefore, though it's never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I believe it has done me good and will do me good. And I say God bless it.
Here, here. Here, here.
Mr. Cratchit, if I hear another word from you, you'll keep your Christmas by losing your situation. Dear, 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 dear. Quite a powerful speaker, sir. When are you going to go into Parliament?
Don't be angry, Uncle. Come, dine with us tomorrow.
I'll see you.
But why? Why?
Why did you get married?
Because I fell in love.
Because I fell in... Good evening.
You never came to see us before that happened. Why give that as a reason for not coming now?
Good evening, sir.
But I want nothing from you. I ask nothing of you.
Well, you won't get it, so you won't be disappointed, will you?
We've never had a quarrel to which I've been party. So why not let us part friends?
Good evening, sir.
Well, I'm sorry with all my heart to find this a relative. But I've made the trial in homage to Christmas, and I'll keep my Christmas humor to the last. So a Merry Christmas, Uncle.
Good evening, sir.
And a Happy New Year.
You're a noisy devil. That's what you are, sir.
Merry Christmas, Bob Cratchit. And the same to you, sir, and many of them. And not forgetting your good lady, Mrs. Fred.
Thank you, Cratchit. A Merry Christmas to you. A Merry Christmas.
The nephew leaves, and Cratchit shuts the door after it. Silhouettes of three caroling children approach the window of Scrooge's office. He closes his workbook and shakes his pen. Scrooge lifts his head, scowling, and turns towards the window, throwing down his pen. Their little cherub faces bunched together on the other side of Scrooge's snow-capped window. A young boy with soulful eyes peers through. Scrooge takes a ruler from his desk, turns, points it, and sneers at the young boys and girls. They scramble off into the streets.
I notice.
It's 7 o'clock, sir.
That clock's fast. By the way, I suppose you'll want all day off tomorrow, eh?
Well, sir, if it's quite convenient.
It isn't convenient. It isn't fair. If I were to stop half a crown for it, oh, you'd be mightily ill-used, I'd be bound, wouldn't you? Don't think I'm ill-used, do you? When I have to pay a whole day's wages. No work.
It only happens once a year, sir.
That's a pretty excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December. Well, I suppose you've got to have it. Here, there's the key. You see, sir, that you're here only earlier, next morning.
Bob Cratchit helps Scrooge on with his scarf and coat. Scrooge walks with a cane. Cratchit exits after him.
And a Merry Christmas.
Bah! Humbug!
Scrooge exits to the left. Cratchit wraps his arms around himself, patting his chest, and walks ahead. Scrooge ignores a beggar asking for money. Scrooge's nephew, Freddy, buys a wreath, which the vendor adds to Freddy's pile of packages. Children slide in their shoes along a frozen strip of ice in the snow. Adults watch the fun. The kids fall, laughing and playing in the street. Cratchit sees them and cannot resist. He runs ahead, raises his arms for balance, and takes a turn himself, skiing with only his shoes, sliding along the frozen strip, smiling like the youngsters who continue their game after him.
Please call 1-800-FIGHT-RP or mail your donation now to Post Office Box 900, Woodland Hills, California, 91365. Now to end blindness. That's 1-800-FIGHT-RP to let the children see.
One Christmas memory was I was in Las Vegas with my grandfather, and my mom came out in a Winnebago. For absolutely no reason, drove from L.A. in a Winnebago with some presents in it and a little toy motorcycle for my brother and probably something embarrassing like a ballerina outfit for me. And then we all had a road trip back home together. So that was fun.
When he appears upon the Hollywood screen, he bursts upon it with the incandescence of the brightest stars of all. Our outstanding actor, sharing memories of Christmas past, Samuel L. Jackson.
The thing about Christmas basically is my birthday is 4 days before Christmas. So I always got like kind of pushed to the side for Christmas. So when I started talking about my birthday, it was like, okay, well, go get one of those things under the tree. You know, not the big one. So that's pretty much what Christmas was. But it was always joyous because it was a Tennessee Christmas. It was in the South. A neighborhood full of kids. The sound of Christmas morning was everybody had a new pair of skates, so you knew it was Christmas morning. So, and Christmas wasn't Christmas without a gun. So I got guns every year because we play gun games like I do now. And I love Christmas. It's a great holiday.
Scrooge tries to make his way through the bustling townspeople who gather around the salesman whose dead, headless geese with no feathers hang with their feet dangling above him.
Merry Christmas, sir.
Scrooge walks away from the stand and is the only frowning man in a crowd full of smiles. Scrooge enters an empty restaurant, tapping his cane on the table to get the waiter's attention. He was fast asleep, head down on the table. Wearing a white apron, he gets up from his chair and hands Scrooge the menu. Outside, a tall, long, dark-haired lad holds a torch and taps on the door. A young woman wearing a white cap with a black ribbon answers the door. She takes the packages from the boy. Her brown hair curls out of her hat. One package falls, and a dirty-faced lad hands it back to Freddy as he enters the house. A thin brown tree, all branches and no leaves, lean toward Cratchit's house. Cratchit tiptoes in the snow, carrying an armload of presents and a goose. A man climbs out of a carriage, tipping his hat to the crowd. A woman wearing a tiara and a long black headpiece passes by two guards wearing gray wigs. The couple ascends the grand staircase. The room is full of people who are ready for a party in fancy gowns and handsome suits. A richly dressed couple climb out of the carriage. A small boy approaches the guard. Silhouettes of a mob of people are behind a metal gate. In a huge kitchen, chefs with high white hats with round tops and white coats hustle about the kitchen, kneading dough, carrying food. One chef eagerly samples the cooking wine, drinking a whole glass. His associate joins him in a drink. A cook with really bushy black eyebrows and bulging eyes bastes a goose. Another cook, chubby-cheeked and round, shakes his head. The head chef hits a boy in the face with a pad. Other chef flips steaks from pans into the air. Another bastes some chickens. A black-haired chef takes a large plate full of food and throws it out the window to the hungry crowd who grab it like they're catching a baseball at a ball game. Scrooge, however, eats alone, hunched over his workbook at the rounded booth of the restaurant.
Tell him to stop that noise.
The waiter gives Scrooge a sorrowful look and heads for the door. The ladies and gentlemen are dining at their party.
Will you make your speech now, or will you let the ladies and gentlemen continue to enjoy themselves? Call silence for the loyal toast. My lord, ladies and gentlemen, pray silence for the Right Honourable the Lord Mayor of London. My lord.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, her most gracious majesty, the Queen.
The invited guests are standing up in the dining room, raising their glasses, singing the national anthem of England. Four pillars stand tall behind them. Lit candles decorate the Christmas tree, statues fill arched pedestals, the crystal chandeliers decorated with a wreath. Outside, the paupers watch through the gate and join in singing God Save the Queen. Guests raise their glasses higher and drink heartily. Scrooge puts on his black hat, gets up from his booth, elbows the waiter aside, and then leaves the restaurant. The waiter pockets the change and glares at Scrooge. Scrooge limps along the snowy street. A furry black dog with a curled tail and pointed ears barks at Scrooge. His owner, a tall man with a long scarf, pulls tightly on the dog's leash, ignoring Scrooge.
What the devil are you doing? Frightening people out of their wits.
Scrooge enters an open gate with elegantly designed snail-shaped curls on the bars. He turns and his shadow falls upon another snow-topped black iron gate. He reaches into his pocket, searches for his key, and finds it deep in his pants pocket. Looking up at the door knocker, he is startled by the sight of a face appearing within the knocker. He struggles with the key, trying to open the door. He finally gets in. His hand shakes as he lights the white candle on the table. Then he blows out the match. He slams the door shut, locks, and double checks all the locks behind him. He takes the candle off the table. His shadow on the wall grows larger as he climbs the stairs. He lights his own way with a single candle. Scrooge reaches a dark room. Only a light shines through the window blinds. He looks left, right, and in front of him. He bangs underneath a tabletop, searching with his cane. The frightened Scrooge walks with trepidation, peering around a door, holding his cane out in front of him. He pushes away a curtain with his cane and moves underneath it. His eyes grow large and his face contorts as he stares ahead. Curtains hang by the window. Material in the shape of a large man with a long coat stands next to a straight wooden pillar with a bulbous shape at the bottom. Scrooge walks towards it. His cane is aimed straight out like a pistol. He pokes the piece of cloth with a cane. Scrooge sets down the candle and walks back to a door. Opening it, the wind blows the curtain around and an empty bucket falls down at his feet, startling him. He kicks it. Scrooge locks the window and re-enters the first room. advances to the pile of clothes and takes some clothes from that pile that frightened him and throws his scarf to the ground. He walks away from it, picks his candle back up, and squeezes through the narrow doorway. He glances behind him at the room, looking sheepish. Scrooge pushes the door tightly closed, then goes to his right, enters a room, and lays the candle on the mantel. And sits down in front of the cold fireplace. He moves a small plate out of the way and eats his gruel from a bowl that's been sitting on the table. A small metal bell hanging on the wall shakes slowly. Scrooge stops eating and turns to glance up at it. The bell repeats more rapidly against the wall. The mysterious, insistent clatter drives him out of his chair. He looks out the dark blinds of his window. Peers left, peers right. Sees nothing. Scrooge's face is tense, his lips tight, his hand trembles. Scrooge jumps, his fists are clenched, he shivers, wrapping his arms around his chest. The front door swings open. No one is visible in the doorway.
Look, Ebenezer Scrooge, for only you can see me.
Demand with me.
Much.
Oh. Yeah.
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
In life? Why do you trouble me?
It is required of everyone that the spirit within him roared among his fellow men. And if that spirit goes not forth in life, it is condemned to do so after death. Mice beyond the narrow limits of our money-changing hall. So I cannot rest. I cannot stay. Anger anywhere.
You... after death? Why?
I wear the chain I forged in life. I made it, link by link. Would you know the weight and length of the coil you bear yourself?
Speak words of comfort to me, Jacob Marley. Speak words of comfort.
Comfort? I have none to give. I am here to warn you, to save you, if that be possible.
To warn? To save me. From what?
From such a fate as mine. To wander through the world and witness what I cannot share, but might have shared on earth and turned to happiness.
But you were always a good man of business, Jacob. Business.
Mankind would have been my business. Charity, forbearance, benevolence, all were my business. As they should be yours. Now heed me, for my time is short. You will be haunted by three spirits. Without their visits, you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. You shall behold the visions of a Christmas past, a Christmas present, and a Christmas yet to come. Expect the first when the clocks strikes midnight tonight.
Marley!
to see me no more.
Mommy!
Scrooge is mesmerized. He trembles. He follows the sound. The window opens. His eyes are wide. His eyebrows raised. He sticks his head out of the window. There's a snowstorm outside. Snowflakes twirl about the sky. A house can be seen in the distance, smoke blowing out the chimney. Scrooge puts his hands to his head, running his fingers through his hair. The window slams shut. Scrooge turns and looks back at it, heads for the window, and looks outside. Not a soul is out there. The storm, however, has stopped. Scrooge scratches his head, looking exhausted.
Here's the holiday release, a look at it, of Universal.
For the families we have lost, for the lives of our children, we must take a stand. Whatever happens, whatever you see, there's no coming back. Come on. 47 Ronin, rated PG-13.
Hi, I'm Stan Lee, and I've tried to create a lot of heroes in my time, and now it's your chance to be a hero and see if you can't help find a cure for blindness, which is probably one of the most heroic things that anybody could address himself or herself to.
No child should ever be blind. Please call 1-800-FIGHT-RP to save children's eyesight.
She's bright and shiny. She looks like a Christmas ornament on anybody's tree. And to share her memories of Christmas past, here is the rather remarkable Sandra Bullock.
My family has a very traditional Christmas. I always go back to D.C. And we celebrated on the evening of the 24th all the way into the morning of the 25th. Very traditional. We have rituals that it isn't broken. Mom pulls out the tree. We leave the house. She decorates. It's almost like the Christmas angel, which is what we did in Europe. You know, the kids leave the house, the bell rings, and everyone runs in, and everything's miraculously there. So it's nice. You don't have to do any of the work. So me and Dad and sister go out and go see some movies, and we come back, and the house is transformed. So, yeah, it's always in the same place. Always.
Warner Brothers feels like they have a hit on their hands, and here's their holiday edition.
The Hobbit is the number one movie in the world.
Hold on!
Desolation of Smaug, now playing.
Of course, Disney Studios will have a holiday special. Here's a quick look.
Top critics are raving about Saving Mr. Banks.
They will rejoice.
Oh, I love it.
Saving Mr. Banks, rated PG-13, now playing.
Her father was a dear friend of mine. He had a voice like velvet, and suddenly, he and Maria produced a beautiful young girl who sings like an angel. And right now, here's Natalie Cole.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping at your nose. Yuletide carols being sung by a choir. Folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe helps to make the season bright. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if reindeer really know how to fly. And so I'm offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.
Hello, I'm Governor Kathleen Sebelius. This year, our office joins the national network of Voices for Vision.
Hi, I'm Governor Brian Schweitzer. I want to send a special holiday wish to the people of our great state and folks around the nation.
This is Governor Steve Beshear of the great Commonwealth of Kentucky. Through these special times in our country, many Americans are by themselves, facing challenges in their ever-changing lives. I would like to take this time to send out special greetings to the unsighted and vision impaired.
Happy holidays. This is Governor Charlie Crist of the great state of Florida. I'd like to take this time to send out a special greeting to the unsighted and vision impaired. In this time of peace and giving, I send you my special greeting.
Howdy, I'm Texas Governor Rick Perry, and I hope you and your family are having a blessed holiday season. I want to extend a unique wish for peace and joy to individuals who are blind or visually impaired. Every year, Voices for Vision does remarkable work, bringing the sounds of the season to our friends and neighbors whose vision has been diminished. RP International's audio greeting cards are an essential part of that effort. With this in mind, I'm honored to add my voice to this growing chorus on behalf of the great state of Texas as the eyes of Christmas audio greetings spread joy across our world.
Hello, I'm George Bush. If someone you know needs help fighting blindness, call RP International 1-800-FIGHT-RP.
Sony Columbia is proud to present the following as their holiday edition.
What else have you done for us besides Bin Laden?
I've done nothing else.
There's nobody else hidden away on some other floor. There is just us.
Don't you think she's a little young for the hard stuff?
Washington says she's a killer.
Oh my God, is that what I think it is?
We will never find him. He is one of the disappeared ones.
If you're right, the whole world's gonna want in on this.
Zero Dark 30, rated R. Now in select cities, everywhere, January 11th.
Hi, I'm Oliver Stone. I'm proud to be a member of the founding committee of Theater Vision. It's a movement to bring description and narration into motion pictures throughout the country so that people who have a diminished sight or no sight at all can see the movies in some form and understand them with us. As part of our community, I urge you to help and join by calling 1-800-FIGHT-RP. 1-800-FIGHT-RP. Thank you.
It is a rare time when a man's name is preceded by a number, but we all know that famous number, 007, from Sean Connery on to Pierce Brosnan.
Christmas was always magical, and wonderful. Just the sheer joy of Father Christmas, Santa Claus coming, and of course the Irish love to tell yarns and stories and stuff like this, so I had uncles and aunts who could tell the best stories. But there was also sad ones as well. There was a few Christmases which were quite lonely and sad and all of that kind of childhood nonsense. But ultimately, joyous, you know, and growing up in Ireland, you know, the Catholic religion celebrates Christmas enormously, and the birth of Jesus, and, you know, the three wise men, and the nativity, and being, I was an altar boy, so the sheer spectacle has a profound effect on one's life. And I suppose maybe it's the reason I'm an actor. There's a certain, those were the first performances, you know, going out and serving Mass on Christmas night in front of a church and getting into the costume, the cassock and everything like this. That's why I'm an actor. Suddenly figured it out. Anyway, I love Christmas.
You know, that's the one thing that perhaps can join us all together in a spirit of brotherhood and peace. So, in that spirit, please consider the people who cannot see this holiday and call now, please, at 1-800-FIGHT-RP. Now, back to our movie.
Outside, a man in black puts out the street light with a long stick. Scrooge is sleeping.
Well, the clock and all's well.
Town crier.
Well, the clock and all's well.
Scrooge opens his eyes, waking from his sleep. Pulls the covers off. The curtain moves. Scrooge stares at it. There in front of him, a glowing, ghostly figure appears, shaped like a man. It's a foggy white outline in front of him.
Spirit of Christmas past, I am here to show you the things that have been. Look back beyond the gulf of vanished years.
Balding man rises out of the glowing shape. His hand is on his head.
But, sir, that's impossible.
Then I shall have no alternative but to take immediate steps to recover it.
But, sir, you must see that if...
That is the way I conduct my business.
You don't mean sell us up?
That is precisely what I do mean.
But, sir, I couldn't work in the hospital.
Mr. Scrooge, I beg of you.
Good day.
Can't be so unjust.
Give us a little more time. A week.
Please.
In a flashback to an earlier time, a much younger Scrooge opens his book, ignoring the couple who stand over him. Another woman watches. She wears a bonnet with light-colored, curly bangs peeking out the top. She stares at Scrooge, shaking her head. The dejected couple hold each other and then leave. Belle, the woman in the fur-lined coat, enters Scrooge's office and looks at Scrooge with disdain. She approaches him.
Oh, Belle. I didn't hear you come in.
So it is true.
What do you mean?
What they say. You're a man without pity, without remorse, who weighs everything in the scale of profit and loss.
Belle!
I couldn't help you.
This is business. If I were to allow sentiment to enter this counting house, I should be in the bankruptcy court within a year. And as for that couple who've just gone out, well, set your mind at rest about them. Worthless, shiftless pair. I've had my good money. Now I want to avoid paying it back.
Your money. Your good money. They asked you for a little breathing space, a little time in which to pay. That's all.
Enough of this, Belle. I am ready to make allowances for your feelings as a woman. But I must ask you to leave my business affairs alone. When you marry me, I shall insist.
She takes off her engagement ring, lays it on the ledge, and turns away from Ebenezer Scrooge.
I've tried hard not to believe what they've said about you. I'd give anything not to believe it now. But the evidence of my own eyes and ears, I must believe. You are not always so. But I can see now that one passion only engrosses you. Gain.
What then? Even if it were so, I'm not changed towards you.
You are changed. Changed in every way. You're not the man. Our contract's an old one, made when we were poor and content to be so.
She leaves the young Scrooge. He stands facing the bookcase. He looks down. The scene changes and the older, haggard Scrooge leans against a white wall. His eyes are closed. Scrooge opens his eyes and looks to the left. Children about 7 to 10 years old dance, holding hands in a circle around a Christmas tree. It's decorated with tinsel. Belle joins them. She sits back on the couch. The children all jump in a pile on top of her. The children all run to their father, little girls with bows in their hair and short, puffy sleeves reach into their daddy's pocket.
I saw an old friend of yours this afternoon.
Oh, who was it?
You guess.
How can I? I don't know. It wasn't Mr. Scrooge.
Mr. Scrooge it was. I passed his office window, and as it was not shut up and there was a candle inside, I could scarcely help seeing him. His partner's on the point of death, I hear. And there he sat, alone. Quite alone in the world, I do believe.
Belle's husband sits beside her on the arm of the couch. She kisses him. She hugs the boy next to her.
Spirit, I cannot bear it. Haunt me no more.
I told you these were the shadows of the things that have been. That they are what they are. Do not blame me.
Take me, Belle!
Scrooge swings his hand down, hitting the flame of the burning candle. Sleeping restlessly, Scrooge opens his eyes.
It's 1 o'clock, I know it is.
Scrooge lifts his head up, then hides his face under the blanket. Pulls the sheets down. Gets out of his bed. He sees a huge fat man in a Santa suit with a white collar and belt, but has a crown on his head with multiple points. He's eating pieces of chicken with both hands and drinking from a goblet.
Come in and know me, better man. I am the ghost of Christmas present. Look upon me. You have never seen the like of me before.
Never.
Have never walked forth with the younger members of my family, meaning I am very young. My elder brothers, born in those later years.
I don't think I have. I'm afraid I have not. Have you many brothers, Spirit?
More than 1,800.
A tremendous family to provide for. Spirit, conduct me where you will. Already I have been forth under compulsion and learned a lesson which is working now. If you have aught to teach me, let me profit by it.
The spirit makes a face, lips puckered, jowls wrinkled.
See how your poor clerk, with his paltry 15 shillings a week, which you so grudgingly dole out to him, keeps Christmas. Touch my robe.
Scrooge raises his hand high, then lowers it, touching the spirit's sleeve. The spirit is seated in front of a lit fire. Long stockings are hung in front of it.
As a child, you know, my Christmases were always exactly the same.
like any family, you have traditions. You know what I mean? You go to grandma's house and you get there by 2 or 3. You go to church in the morning, then you go to grandma's house and she's cooked all the same foods that she's cooked every day for the last 10 years you've been alive. And that's kind of how it is. And then they play the same music, and then the kids fight to get put their music on. And, you know, it's just the same thing.
George Clooney, the matinee idol for all of America and the world indeed. But he stops being a matinee idol to recall a favorite Christmas memory.
Okay, quick Christmas remembrance. My sister had braces, and I used to, living back in Kentucky, I used to rub my feet on the ground. You could get static electricity by rubbing your feet on the ground. And I remember talking my sister into, it was Christmas Day, and I talked my sister into smiling and letting me rub my feet on the ground and touching her braces. And she said, okay. So I did it, and I came over and I hit her. And I don't think my finger, it was throbbing. I don't think it ever got to her teeth, and it zapped her. And she started crying. She said it hurt. And I said, well, that's because you weren't grounded. You have to hold on to the Christmas tree. So I got her to hold on to the Christmas tree and smile, and I did it again, and I nailed her. And then that was, that's my Christmas remembrance.
Here's sporting great Bob Costas.
This is Bob Costas. The holiday season is a special one at the National Shrine of Our Lady of the Snows here in Belleville, Illinois, overlooking the great Mississippi River Valley. Behind me is the Way of Lights, over 1 million white lights strung on trees and shrubs along a 1.5-mile route through the grounds of the shrine. 250,000 people of all faiths visit here each year in their cars, by heated trolley, even by horse-drawn carriage. Traveling this journey to Bethlehem through a fantasy of lights, the visitor passes the 85-foot-tall Millennium Spire. With thousands of candles at the base of the spire, it's a beacon of inspiration for a better world. In the Annunciation Garden, with its larger-than-life sculpture, 4 large bells toll each hour as we come to the outdoor amphitheater. 2,500 seats, plus the surrounding hillsides, can accommodate thousands of people. Rising from the top of the shell is a 50-foot abstract M, which stands for Mary, the mother of Jesus, who is Our Lady of the Snows. This depiction of the Christmas story leads to the Lourdes Grotto, a replica of the famed grotto in Lourdes, France. Here, an outdoor nativity display completes the journey to Bethlehem under an awesome 12-foot lighted star. In the visitor's center of the Shrine of Our Lady of the Snows is another nativity scene, this one built entirely of Lego blocks. In the Christmas Village is a display of beautifully decorated Christmas trees. This trip to Belleville, Illinois, allows the eyes of Christmas to bring you another facet of the celebration of Christmas around the world.
Hi, I'm Stan Lee, and I've tried to create a lot of heroes in my time, and now it's your chance to be a hero and see if you can't help find a cure for blindness, which is probably one of the most heroic things that anybody could address himself or herself to.
No child should ever be blind. Please call 1-800-FIDE-RP to save children's eyesight.
The Eyes of Christmas brings light and hope and laughter to the eyes of blind children, adults, and seniors all across the world. I'm proud and happy to be part of this Stop Blindness campaign and hope you do your part to light up darkened lives. Call 1-800-FIGHT-RP and light up the holiday season for someone who could see through your eyes. That's 1-800-FIGHT-RP. You can write to the Eyes of Christmas at P.O. Box 900, Woodland Hills, California, 91365. Thanks.
My friends, I believe in this cause, and I really hope you do too. Please give now, 1-800-FIGHT-RP, or go to rpinternational.org.